Helene is breaking records in the Southeast as the UN is holding its Climate Week here in New York, where scientists and world leaders have met to discuss concerns about bigger and stronger storms, along with temperature changes across the globe. Joining us now, science educator and the Planetary Society CEO, Bill Nye, you know him well, and University of Pennsylvania Presidential Distinguished Professor of Earth and Environmental Science, and author of Our Fragile Moment, How Lessons from Earth's Past Can Help Us Survive the Climate Crisis, and a whole lot of other books. Michael Mann, gentlemen, it's really great to have you. I will note I'll have even more time next time if we shorten up that title of yours. You've got to be less distinguished, my friend.
Thanks, Katie. It's great to be with you.
I wish we were talking about better news. Tell me about, you were nodding your head as Melissa was talking, Marissa was talking about rapid intensification.
Yeah, it's something we talk a lot about these days. You know, these storms intensify far more rapidly than they used to. And there's basic underlying science that predicted that decades ago. You warm up the oceans, there's more energy, more evaporation of moisture from the ocean that provides the energy to intensify these storms. They intensify faster. And we are seeing that. And the threat is, you know, as you heard here, you have less time to prepare because something that was just a weak tropical storm is a major hurricane within a matter of 24 hours.
I keep hearing people say, you know, climate scientists go out and they say it's the end of the world, the climate change is here, disaster is coming, but everything's been fine. And then I look at them and I say, well, what about that hurricane or what about that fire? There are pockets of this country that are not fine. It's not happening, you know, it's not, you know, the end of the world like in a science fiction movie at the moment, but there are real life effects and a lot of people that are being displaced and killed.
And it's also when your power goes out. Yeah. That's when the end of the world gets us in the developed world. And people who live in that area now have just not just rainwater flooding, but flooding from the ocean, which is salty, which rusts your car. And then you can't get insurance for where you park your car. And the storm surge was in English units 12 feet or something.
Something like that. Yeah.
So that's a first floor of a building. So everything... If you live on the first floor, everything you own is kind of ruined. And that will not, insurance companies will not keep doing
that. So where do you live now if you want to stay safe from the effects of climate
change? Well, just farther inland. And so, for example, I was in Miami. So there's two cities. There's Miami Beach and Miami. In Miami, the higher ground used to be where poorer people lived, but now it's getting gentrified. Because people are moving inland away from, I mean, it's, I'm chuckling because it is ironic. But the other thing that happened, as far as rapid intensification, the storm was moving very fast. So you not only had the fast spinning winds, but it was moving south to north fast. And this contributed to a longer term problem. People who have lived in the area for a long time have been through several big storms. They didn't quite get how fast it was going to show up.
Let me add one more thing.
Based on their experience.
Yeah. As Bill said, how fast it's going, but also it was a huge storm, and there's some evidence that these storms are getting bigger. The hurricane strength winds extend further out. The bigger the storm, the more water you pile up. The faster those winds, the more water you pile up. And so these record storm surges are caused by both these very powerful hurricanes that extend over very large areas.
UN Climate Week this week. Any consensus happening at the UN?
We're just one international meeting from solving
From solving it?
Yes. Oh, just one more. No, everybody, people say to me, Bill Nye, science guy, what can I do about climate change? What can I do about climate change? Well, tell you why people's vote. Right now, we hear so much about the undecided voters. And this is, I'm being as...
Diplomatic, generous,
magnanimous. How can you not tell the difference, people? One side is in support of doing something about these massive problems associated with climate change. The other side is pretending it's not happening. And you guys, we all want a villain and so on, but it really has been the fossil fuel industry that's worked really hard to suppress the science.
How do you, a lot of people, when they hear that, though, they think, God, you guys are being, you're being too crazy, you're being too strict, too harsh. I like my way of life.
Okay.
I like my car.
Yes.
I like ordering things on Amazon.
Yes.
I like all the plastic that I use
play
in
disc
my
golf.
Life.
I'm crazy for plastic.
Yeah, but that's the thing. I mean, it is so ingrained in our life. And what they're looking for is for science to come up with a way to solve this problem.
Well, so we claim on our side of it, we claim that we have enough energy to take care of everything right now if we just could apply it. And so the longest journey begins with but a single step. Mm-hmm. We will phase out fossil fuel use, and we will phase in renewable energy. But just when it comes November 5th, everybody, you got to vote for the Democrats. I'm doing my best here. For many years, I've been the head of a organization that we work very hard to be political but not partisan mm-hmm. in space exploration. Be that as it may, right now the choice is clear. So you can, everybody out there, you can hate me, you can hate him, you can hate everything, but when it comes to doing something about climate change, you've got to vote for Harris Walz, and that's what Too Hot Not to Vote is all about. Back to you, Michael.
Yeah, I just want to add a little bit of a note of optimism here during Climate Week. There's some preliminary numbers now that have come in that suggest that 2024 will see a drop in global carbon emissions.
Oh, that's amazing.
You heard it here first. And that means that our efforts are starting to make a difference.
Which ones?
So total carbon emissions, mostly from fossil fuel burning. Some of it is from deforestation or reforestation, the opposite direction. And so the net effect of changes in land use and fossil fuel burning is a small decrease, which means policies are making a difference. That's the good news.
So
the bad
news,
they don't go
have policy,
yeah.
then we can change things.
Yeah.
Electric cars.
So electric cars, everybody, are not a panacea, but we have built all these roads. I mean, my goodness, have we built roads to the point where about 1% of North America is paved? And so let's use them. And so the electric car is nominally at least four times as efficient as a gas-powered car, and in many cases, five times as efficient. And then when you drive it around, you're not spreading the pollution out all over the city. It's being concentrated someplace. And if that place happens to be a fossil fuel fueled power plant, you can filter or bag the particulates, the stuff that comes out, and then one day we will phase those out. Don't close any existing nuclear power plants. We'll get to that. But right now, renewables are coming on so strongly, so fast, that international emissions are going down.
You have only a few seconds unless you want to piss off Nicole Wallace.
I don't want to do that.
No, shan't.
We're bending the curve. We've got to bend it down even faster if we're going to avert truly catastrophic warming. So we have to build on the policies of this last administration.